Thank you. So this is going to be very different from what's been presented so far. And I'm going to give you the perspective of someone running seismic hazard and what we need to be able to actually use the numerical simulations in running seismic hazard calculations. So 3D simulations includes path specific effects and fault specific, you know, geometry effects. So they're much more idealized to the specific situation you have. And so from a seismic hazard point of view, we would see these as non-ergodic ground motion models. So in that case, the ground motion depends on the site and the source location and not just on magnitude and distance and the site condition. So that's how we start to look at it in that framework. If we have a non-ergodic ground motion model, we need four things. We need the site-specific median. We need the site-specific aleatory variability. So that's going to be our standard deviation that we normally have in the ground motion model. And then we also need the epistemic uncertainties in the median and the epistemic uncertainty in the value of the standard deviation. So we have to have those four things in developing our ground motion models that we're going to run in a seismic hazard calculation. We divide these when we're trying to do simulations. The way we have been approaching this is to divide the problem into two parts, parametric uncertainties and modeling uncertainties. So parametric uncertainties are just things that the uncertainty on the ground motion that's going to come from using different input parameters into the model. So you understand the physical cause of the uncertainty, like a different slip distribution, and we propagate that using the model to propagate the variability of the slip and find out what is the impact on the resulting ground motion. The modeling part is really uncertainties due to the limitations of the method. Okay, so this is using the misfit between the simulations and the observed ground motion. We just say the model doesn't work. It has limited accuracy. And the physical cause of this is not understood. And it's just treated as unexplained randomness in the way that we model the problem. We also have then modeling uncertainty due to different methodologies. So if you had two different methods for doing the simulation and they put in the same slip distribution and 3D velocity model and got different answers, that difference there is going to be a difference in modeling that we need to capture. So we use an uncertainty matrix like this. So there's a lot here and I'll try to explain it, but this is how we've been trying to track all the pieces of the uncertainty for a seismic hazard calculation. So the left-hand column there says aleatory variability. So let's start with that one. And then we break it up into parametric and modeling. So again, the parametric aleatory term is just from multiple realizations of the source, right? That's our physical, physically understood randomization that we're gonna push through the calculation. So we might have different dimensions of the rupture, different slip distributions on the plane. Where does the hypocenter start? What is the rupture velocity distribution and so forth? So all those things go into creating random future sources or rupture models. And we just push those through the simulation methodology. The bottom part, modeling aleatory variability, again, is limitations of the simulation method. Okay. And so again, this is what we can't explain by the model, and we treat it as a random variable. We have to get this empirically because it's based on the limitation of the model. Right? And so we have to be comparing model predictions versus data to be able to get that. We can optimize the parameters that we would be randomizing in the parametric model. For example, we can optimize the rupture slip distribution and the hypocenter location and so forth. And then we'd say, even if we make those parameters as the best possible, what's the remaining aleatory variability? On the right-hand side is our epistemic uncertainty. So we'll start at the epistemic parametric part. So this would be the uncertainty that we're putting in the right distribution of source properties or inputs into the model. So this could be alternative descriptions of the source, like the mean, how you describe the slip distribution is different. There may be a mean and a different standard deviation of where hypocenters are and so forth. Also, a key part here is the alternative 3D velocity model. So we don't know the velocity model and we need to sample or capture the uncertainty in the ground motion due to the uncertainty in the velocity model. And this gives us both uncertainties in the median value prediction and in the aleatory variability that we're calculating. And then the last box here is the epistemic uncertainty for the modeling term. And so this really is, does the simulation method give us the right answer? So we could look at alternative simulation methods and say, how much do they vary? So what's our uncertainty in our average prediction? And then as well, we could look at, from a validation point of view, compare our data to the simulations to the data, say, what is my bias? What's the mean misfit? And what's the standard error of that mean misfit? So if I have a lot of data, my standard error will be smaller. If I have a few, just a small number in my validation, my standard error will be bigger. But I also might have a bias that this is systematically over-predicting and under-predicting 10%, for example, in a particular range. So that's going to give us, again, the uncertainty in the median, and we'll also get an uncertainty in the standard deviation terms. If you think about how ground motion, empirical ground motion models work, they don't have this top parametric part, right? We're just plugging in magnitude and distance, so we don't have random source parameters that we're going to vary. So a ground motion model would only have aleatory variability modeling. That's the sigma of a ground motion model. And the epistemic uncertainty would be from different ground motion models. Let's say we run the hazard for five different ground motion models or five different medians and maybe different values of the standard deviation. So that's what's on the bottom is all that we have on empirical models. If we made an empirical model that included directivity effects and we said we want to add that in and now keep track of the hypocenter, then the location of the hypocenter would move it into parametric terms up here. And we should have a reduced aleatory term as we fit the data better. So this framework we use fits both for empirical models that are simple and as we add more features to the empirical model and also fits the numerical simulation. So this gives us a consistent way to deal with all of these parts of the problem. If we look at these in terms of how we're going to talk about parameters, so we have our sigma parametric and our sigma modeling, and we're going to assume those are independent. And so we can just SRSS them to get our total standard deviation. We're going to run in the hazard calculation. And then we'll have the epistemic uncertainty in the median. That's going to be called sigma mu. And then we'll have our parametric part and our modeling part we talked about. And then we have our epistemic uncertainty in the value of the aleatory variability. So that's sigma sigma. So this is my regular old sigma in the ground motion models. This would be the differences between different ground motion models, or in this for simulations, how good is our median and how good is our standard deviation? How well do we have that constraint? So we've been using this framework for 30 years, actually. And the first time we got this, people said they're talking about the standard deviation of the standard deviation. And yes, that's what we're trying to get at, right? Because our important parameters are medians and sigmas, and we need to know how reliable are the medians and how reliable are the standard deviations as well. So we need all of these pieces for a hazard calculation, all right? So when we get a single realization of a 3D simulation and say, look, here's an example, that's useful for giving you some insight into what possible spatial variations could exist and how on ground motions and giving people an idea or some, maybe some insights, but it's not useful for hazard. I can't use a single realization of a stochastic process. We need means and standard deviations to be able to run hazard. So if we looked at, for example, data from CyberShake or the LBNL simulations, they're based on a single velocity model and we have multiple realizations of the source. So we're getting this term, that's sort of the sigma parametric, that's part of this problem, but we're missing these other terms. We don't have the modeling uncertainty term. We don't have the epistemic uncertainty terms here. Okay, so we don't have these parts for the velocity model, Is that correct? We don't have it. Is my distribution of source parameters right? Is my differences in methodologies captured? And am I getting the right standard deviation or aleatory variability term? So if we look at this right now, we have this one piece and we're missing five of them. So in seismic hazard analysis, if we have missing values, we're gonna assume them. Okay, so if you don't want the hazard person picking values and sticking them in here, the 3D simulations need to start to provide this. And as an example, I can tell you we had simulations from tsunamis. I was running hazard calculations for tsunami runups. And they had, it was the same situation. I was given just the medians from the tsunamis and the aleatory variability. And I had to fill in the rest of these. And that's exactly what I did. So I stuck in numbers based on what we've seen from other empirical models or other natural processes. So we're gonna put values in here, whether you estimated them or not. And so it behooves us to really start to have the simulation groups filling in these numbers rather than having a hazard analyst do it on their own. Okay, so how do we start to get at these pieces? Or let me go through them in a little more detail. So the parametric aleatory term, it's the most straightforward, right? We're just sampling the range of what the basically source inputs are gonna be. But you need a lot of them to get an accurate standard deviation. Typically 30 to 60 realizations of a random process are necessary to get an accurate estimate of a standard deviation. The modeling aleatory term has been missing. Okay, and so this has to come from comparisons with observations because it's trying to deal with the limitations of the model. The problems we have in trying to do this is that we may not have a good 3D velocity model for the regions where we have the ground motion data, right? And also we don't have the geotechnical layer we've been talking about, right? It's missing. So how do you compare quantitatively the numbers from the 3D simulations to your observations? And does that represent that the model isn't working well, or does it really represent that you don't have the right velocity model and that's causing all the problems? And this comes up repeatedly when we start to do validations, even in 1D cases, where the modelers will say, but you know, this isn't a problem with my model, it's a problem with your data that you're using to compare it, right? You don't have all the inputs that they need. We have done validations for the SKEC broadband platform, say 5 years ago, finishing that work, where it was a large effort to go through validations just of the median model misfit from 1D simulations. That took about 2 years. And all of the models were actually revised during that validation process. So it had an impact on how the models work. Right now, what do we do for 3D? We don't have a good full validation of what is the model misfit from 3D simulations. Initially, I would just be looking at the variability from the 1D models, and maybe that's an approximation, and with some idea of how 1D versus 3D, what we see improvements in non-ergodic sigmas versus ergodic sigmas may give us a way to adjust the 1D sigmas. But we have to do something to start to get to those models. The other parts were that are missing parametric epistemic uncertainty. So the key one that's missing is the uncertainty in the 3D velocity model. A realization with the single velocity model, even if we're randomizing the source, doesn't tell me how good is your velocity model. What's the uncertainty in that prediction? So we have to have methods to make a large suite of 3D velocity models, and then that increases the number of simulations, right? That's gonna be a big increase. Then we also need to deal with the uncertainty that we have the right distribution of source model inputs. So we could have different distributions of the sources, and we can probably get at this just by changing weights on the realizations we're using. And so we can do that without having to do more sampling or more simulations. The other missing term, multiple methods, we generally are running each group running one method. We don't have what is that range. And then on a single method, we can look at the bias, but we have to get back to validation. And that's all those issues of how do we get at validation when the input data used for the validation maybe is not adequate. So in all of this, we have to get a lot more realizations. That's what all of this comes back to. And how do you do it in a more efficient way? So I'm going to talk just really briefly about trying to do this. Can we find, this is work Maxime Lecor is working on, to how do we generate a large number of realizations without doing Monte Carlo sampling? And there's other fields that have been working on this problem. And one possible method is called probabilistic learning on manifolds. And these are non-intrusive methods. That is, it doesn't change the program. We don't have to mess with it. It's designed exactly for these problems, expensive large-scale simulations that you can't afford to run thousands of them. So it takes you, it assumes you've got numbers like 50 to 100 simulations available. It's going to learn from the statistics of the very of the input and the output, and try to, and along with physical constraints, and build a way to correlate those two. And then we can then later sample that distribution of inputs and generate additional, here we call learned realizations, okay? And then we can with that try to construct the statistics of the answer. And these are for time series. It's not just the intensity measures like response vector, but you should, these methods are intended for being able to get at a complex vector outputs like a time series. So we're looking at a trial application of this for SW4 to start with a smaller number, because we don't have that, we don't have 50 to 100 yet, but say 25 realizations of the source. We need to know the statistical distribution of the input parameters that is being sampled, and it has to be sampled in a consistent way. Then we would test this model. A really overly simplified description again is it, we're going to model the or approximate the results of the time series as functions of the random variables. And then we're going to later sample more of those random variables to create new realizations. And then we can evaluate this with a second set of realizations that would be needed that gives us a test data, and see, you know, comparing how well this works with the same sort of validation statistics that have been talked about this morning. And our goal is really to determine, is this a method that is well suited to this problem, or does it just fall apart on the ground motion problem? So in summary, what we're trying to do here is deal with all the parts of the uncertainty. The main thing we have right now, the aleatory parametric term, is being generated from multiple realizations of the source. We have those numbers. Most simulation sets are missing the other pieces that we need. We need the aleatory modeling term. We have to get that from 3D, from validations, and that's a difficult problem for us to do. Epistemic parametric, so we have to have alternative 3D velocity models is the key for that. We can deal with probably alternative PDFs of the source distributions just by changing weights. And then we need the epistemic modeling term. This again comes from either different simulation methods or validations. And in the end, we need a larger number of simulations. And so really we want to start to test some alternative methods like the PLOM to see if we can expand the number of realizations without having to just do a huge number of Monte Carlo sampling. Thank you.